to episode 42. Special thanks to Pleasure for that intro. 42 is the answer to the ultimate question of life, the universe, and everything, as we all know. Now, why is 42 special? Squadron 42. That's right. So, doesn't it kind of make sense to make this episode a little bit about Squadron 42? Yes, it does, and that's exactly what we plan to do. So, if you're new to the show, I'm Eric Wingman Peterson. I work for the man himself, Chris Roberts, in making this beautiful game Star Citizen. And we are here to tell you what goes on week to week at Cloud Imperium Games on the making of the game with the teams in the various locations. That's our job, to get the information to you. So let's get right to it, shall we? We have the week in review. We have forum feedback with your questions. And no videos this week, and I want to explain something. A lot of cool videos came in, but this is an episode about Squadron 42, so we are focusing on that. Don't worry, the videos will make it into next week's show. Wide world news with tidbits from the world at large about space, and we have a roundtable interview with some of the people that walked on fire to get that hangar patch out to you during a very busy week. It's gonna be a fun show. Glad you're here. Let's get right to it. What happened in the week in review? Well, we had a couple new hires in LA. We have Alan Precourt, he's a lighting artist. And we have Oka Kiao, a programmer. Two new guys started up. The team out in LA is getting bigger and bigger every day. And I think you'll see a little bit about that coming up with some footage later on today. Office update. Well, what's going on with the Austin office? Yes, indeed. We are getting close. We're getting so close. I can taste it. Please, we're so close. Here's the deal. We actually did a walkthrough video for the employees here in Austin and LA so people could see what the office is going to look like. And somehow, you guys, as ever, ferreted out the information and snuck it up. So some of you got to see a little look around. Now, we want to make sure, we don't want to jinx it. We want to make sure we get that contract signed, and then we'll do a full reveal to everybody. And I think you're going to like it. I think everybody is going to enjoy what we have. The amenities are there. The workspace is large enough for us. And it's time to get out of the basement. I think we all agree on that. We also had the Planet Side Summit. Lots and lots of things happened there. We got all the teams that are working on the Planet Side environments together, and they decided how it's all going to work.
I'm Mark Day. I'm the president of Void Alpha. And at the conference here this week, we're really hoping to meet the other contractors and start working more as a team. Right now, we've been all kind of doing R&D on our own, and I'm really looking forward to be able to share assets between all of us. It'll really help speed up the whole process.
I'm Benoit Beausejour. I'm CTO at Turbulent. I'm looking really forward with this summit to meet with everybody to get time to sync up technically on what the web needs are going to be in all the different projects and different parts of what the teams are building.
So the Planet Side Summit was very, very important to us, and it's very nice to get all the teams on the same page, and we're looking forward to the work. They've got a lot of Planet Side environments to build. Now, as ever, you guys out there, you citizens, have been incredibly generous, and you send us gifts. So we got barbecue, we got rum cake. Yeah, take a look at this.
Hey everybody, we got a gift. And we got a little barbecue and a keg of beer coming in a little bit, but we got something in here. Let's take a look.
Let's see what they are.
Aww. Tortuga Caribbean rum cake.
Aww, that's awesome.
Rum cake. Yeah. Where's Brendan? You know, it's a taste of the island. You know he's gonna be all over this stuff. A gift note from Sven to the most awesome and entertaining development team out there. You're a fan, Sven Three Elves Hartman. Sven Three Elves, thank you very much. What we say, guys?
Thank you.
Got the best citizens in the world. They brought us some barbecue from
Cooper's,
and some beer came from Wolf over there. So why don't you guys tell everybody who you are?
I'm Carman,
which you've met before.
Which you've seen before.
And right. This is... I'm Gaggle.
See there? Citizens, and you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna get our food on. Let's go, let's eat!
And our
thank you guys very, very much.
Awesome.
Thank you guys very, very much.
Thank you. Awesome.
Wow, thank you guys very, very much. Now, I must be honest. There was another citizen who was visiting us last week, Wolf, who has been unbelievably generous. He sent us dipping dots. He sent us kegs of beer. Unfortunately, Wolf was around during a very, very busy time. We didn't get any footage of him, but Wolf, thank you very much. And the bourbon that he sent, sweet. Borders from Wisconsin, unbelievable. Thank you, Wolf. And now it's time for us to bring back fan focus. So continually on Fan Focus, what we want to do is we want to talk about the things that you guys are doing. Now that we've got a little bit out there that you guys can play with and look at, constantly we're getting inundated with really, really cool videos that you guys have put together. Not just like forum feedback questions, but actually taking our assets and making something really, really cool out of this. Now, one person has stood out in that regards in the last week or two. It's Anything FPS on YouTube. I highly recommend you check out his thing. He's done this incredible walkthrough of the constellation. Take a look at that. Isn't that just gorgeous? He's using all the animations. He's putting people in there, all the cloning all of our characters and having them be part of the thing. It's just absolutely beautiful. We've actually reached out to Anything FPS because we think his work is so good that we wouldn't mind him actually working for us in a direct manner. So Anything FPS, if you're watching, you need to answer that HR email I sent. Because we want you in the verse. We also had CitizenCon last week. We had a few technical glitches in there, but we managed to get the show up on the website for everybody to see within the hour. Not sure what happened there. There's a lot of rumors going around, but you know, it's okay. It ends up being pretty good. We had a lot of reveals happening in there. By the way, the party with the fans was fantastic. Hanging out with everybody, getting to meet everybody, rubbing elbows. We had an absolute blast. The people seemed to have a good time. The event was well received. Next year, we're gonna have a much bigger one. Sandy's putting that together. It's gonna be really, really fun for everybody. And we had a big surprise. We had the Squadron 42 surprise. What does that mean? Well, as you can see, this week in the Santa Monica office, all the key players got together and talked about Squadron 42 and how we're going to put the missions together and what's going to be happening and exactly what you will be doing as players in that universe and how it will tie into the big Star Citizen. So a lot of this we've worked on before, but we wanted to bring in the big Aaron Roberts and his team. And I got to tell you, that's a big win for us. Aaron, Nick, Phil, Deggs, all the guys that are coming on board for us, this is going to be incredible. These guys I personally got to work with on Star Lancer and some other projects at Origin. I cannot say enough the quality of their work and the quality of them as human beings. It's a big coup. If you remember Gamescom, right after Gamescom, Chris and I flew over to Manchester to talk to them about possibly coming on board, and they could feel the energy from Gamescom. We got to show them some of the event, and they were like, holy shisa, you know, and they really liked what we're doing. So they thought, you know what, they want to do this with us. And oh my God, such a huge win for us. We really welcome Aaron and the team, and we'll get more from them. We'll fly over there, we'll get some in-depth interviews, we'll show you their office, where they're going to be, what they're going to be working on, and get to meet some more of their players in the future.
The whole thing really got started for Foundry 42. It was actually a conversation I had at the airport, believe it or not, for my brother, where I was actually dropping him off to take a flight back to the US. And although, you know, we've been talking about it would be great to work together and all that kind of stuff for a while and so forth, he basically just said, you know, well, you know, don't you think this is the right time? And he kind of said it while getting out of the car with his bag late to a flight. So, and you know, he had about a 12-hour flight. So it was kind of one of those moments where I said, well, you know, this is obviously a conversation we have to have and discuss and stuff. And so he ended up spending about 10, 15 minutes talking about stuff to give me something to think about. And then, of course, straight after that, he obviously flew back and then we started talking. And then from, you know, this would be really cool, this is something I really want to do, it just really took one moment in that car, have a conversation, and then within, basically, and once I'm kind of that way, once I make up my mind I'm going to do something, and that's it, that switch is flicked. Within 10 days, I basically resigned my position, and I was getting going and creating Foundry 42 and getting that company going in the UK.
And now we'll hear more about Foundry 42 and their role in Squadron 42 and in CIG in the future. We're actually going to go out there, as I said, and we're going to get to meet those guys and have a look around at what they're up to. But now, guess what time it is, guys? It's time for...
Feedback.
There you go. It is time for forum feedback. All right, let's just get right to it.
Epic. Forum feedback.
Epic forum. You ready, Ben?
It's going to be a big one.
It's going to be a big one. Okay, these are Squadron 42 questions from Venator. My understanding that each character will be able to go through the Squadron 42 campaign and enter the persistent universe of Star Citizens afterwards. My question is, will it be possible to have multiple characters play through Squadron 42 simultaneously with NPCs controlling the extra characters? Ooh, that's tough. Ooh. Who wants to take that one? you guys just came from the summit. So.
Okay, so there are going to be a lot of questions about this stuff, so we'll try to be direct about the questions we're facing at a time. So you can't play multiplayer like all the way through. It's a drop-in mechanic that we're going to be using. So what's going to happen is your friends, and not your NPC characters, but your friends, can drop in and join you on a mission at any given time and be a wingman, but it's not, they're not going to be playing through the campaign, walking around the carrier with you or anything like that.
Okay, cool. From Hermit Boy, he says, will we be able to advance in rank while playing Squadron 42? If so, how would this affect our character once our tour of duty is complete and we enter the persistent universe?
Oh. The answer is yes, absolutely. Our inspiration is the original Wing Commander, and one thing Wing Commander lost over the years was it went away from that increasing in rank because they had to do the live action with Mark Hamill and they couldn't change his rank badge. But with Squadron 42, we can do that, and it absolutely will have an impact on how your character is treated after the campaign, both positively and negatively.
You'll have a better reputation, perhaps, if you moved higher in the military. Of course, there is the ruling for advancing in rank is don't suck, right? Mm-hmm. You don't advance in rank just because we give it to you.
It's not always the case sometimes.
Exactly. You know, not everybody likes a high-ranking military officer. Maybe pirates aren't going to be so fond of you if you were a colonel in the war killing them all.
Good point.
That's
good
true.
Point. All right, good answers, guys. From Don Quixote, when players leave the military, exactly what would they be able to take with them? Thank you in advance, Wingman, and happy 42nd episode. Well, thanks. I appreciate that. Thank you. Without you guys, there is no 42 episodes. It's amazing. So
it.
Will they be able to leave the military, and what will they be able to take with them?
I think a lot of people are wondering if they can, like, take their ships or their sidearms or whatever. I'm like, no.
We need those for the war. With the
yeah. Yeah, that's military stuff. You know, they're not going to give it to you when you leave.
Well, there you go. So, yeah, and when you muster out, you don't get to take.
But there will be something. You might get, like, a tattoo from Squadron 42, and you'll get, you know, reputation. You might have medals you take with you, that kind of thing.
Pleasure already has a tattoo, doesn't he?
That tattoo is amazing.
It's really, really cool. I mean, he's already tatted up there, so.
So the game better not suck. We have to get that tattoo.
We told him we were changing it to Squadron 43, and he about had a conniption. And that's just the fun of it.
I'm sorry, right. Pleasure.
Yeah, sorry about that. From one of our subscribers, Druid, he says, dear Wingman, will those that complete Squadron 42 before joining the wider universe, being former military, have any easier time with the authorities in regards to weaponry their ships are equipped with, or greater access to military-grade hardware?
Mm.
What do you think? Who's got this one?
We've talked about that. We actually have talked about whether or not all the top gear is available to all players, and my thought is that if you didn't serve in the military, or you have a bad rap with the UEE for some other reason, you can't get to it. So, yeah, I would think that military service might give you some access, at least, to some things that other people can't get.
But. You can't get it legitimately, but there's always options for those who want to live outside the law.
Ben, you lawbreaker.
That is true. I think Ben is going to be breaking the law, out there on the edges.
I think Ben's going to be spending a lot of time in the brig of my Avenger.
Is that right? From Mordhaus. Will we be able to not become a citizen after completing Squadron 42 military service? This seems to tie into that. Also, will we be able to leave the military early, partway through our career, if we find we'd rather be out making our own way in the universe? That's interesting. Who wants to take that?
The answer is yes. Yes, you can not accept your citizenship at the end if you're going to live outside the law.
Breathe easy, you pirates.
So the player gets a choice, essentially, yeah. Whether or not they want to become a citizen.
When we were meeting with the guys yesterday, that was kind of the imagery that came up during the meeting was you get your citizenship papers, and if you just don't sign them, then you're fine.
Although, if you're going to be out there raiding shipping after Squadron 42, you're not going to keep your citizenship for very long.
Yeah, that seems to be the kind of the way it would be, right? You automatically get citizenship or you can accept it, and then you might lose it. Just like it's like the right to vote here in the U.S., right? If you get convicted of a felony, you no longer have that right.
There you go.
So, seems to work. From Richard Bird, in Squadron 42, is it possible to be discharged if you suck? Is there a losing path to the story, i.e., don't suck?
And it's Brid, by the way. That was not a typo.
Oh, well, okay. Richard Brid. Oh, Brid, not Bird. Brid.
Yeah,
sorry.
Bride.
Okay.
I don't know. One of those.
So, what happens if you suck? Are we kicking you out?
We're going to have a losing pathway.
There is.
you've played some of Chris Roberts' past games, they're amazing losing.
You have to lose once just to see what happens.
That is true. That is true. You know, I think on one of the games we did, I think it was Wing 4, I believe, we did a survey or we checked after it was out how much people actually played. And most people only played like 27, 28% of the game. You know, so there's so much out there they missed. But the hardcore people, like...
I don't know anyone like that.
I don't know anybody like that either.
Never heard of any of those
none
people.
None of our friends lists. Nobody on our Facebook pages are like that. From Sloney. Hi, Wingman. Will Squadron 42... Well, hello, Sloney. Will Squadron 42 feature co-op mode? And if so, will there be a counter-operative mode where other players can take the role of the enemy? Do we let them drop in and be enemy?
I don't know if Chris talked about that or not. I mean, so people seem to have the impression that he did. What they're planning to do right now is work on the drop-in mode for cooperative play. And then, you know, maybe somewhere along the line we might have time to...
So, man, that would be really tough if you, like, have a mission you can't get to and a bunch of people that are really good pilots decide to keep not letting anybody pass that mission.
Of course.
You know, that might be tough. I guess maybe you can always say you don't want them in there or whatever.
The counter to that is you don't want your friends to drop in and then just fly off into a star or something and let you finish the mission for free, so.
Well, that's true, too.
We have to be careful.
Oh, that's a good point. So it's a lot to be balanced there.
Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah, fair enough. From Augie the Great. Hi, Wingman. Can I do the entire campaign co-op? If I do the entire campaign co-op with, say, my brother, will we both get credit for it in the Persistent Universe?
You're not going to get the same credit, but we're talking about maybe special rewards for wingmen who help out the main player.
Mm-hmm.
I think special rewards for wingmen is always a good thing.
How about wingmen's wingmen?
Wingmen's wingmen's wingmen? Wouldn't that just be extra wingmen?
I'm my second wingman twice removed.
My second wingman twice removed, the one without the hair, you know, whatever. I don't know. Yeah.
Our family tree is kind of
so,
strange.
So we did kind of answer that.
Yeah, you can't play through the whole thing together, but yeah, there are rewards for. Yeah, we answered that.
From Circe, C-I-R-S-P-H-E. How would you guys say that? Circe. In Squadron 42, if I jumped into my friend's game and help him with a mission, do I get any rewards of any kind?
And see, Ben just answered that.
Yeah.
You kind of did. I
stacked up some questions here that this kind of duplicate.
Did you read the answer right now?
Did you read ahead? All right, well, so that's already been answered.
Yes.
From Blazer, congrats to 42 episodes of The Hangar. Thank you very much. That's all due to you guys. Will my Squadron 42 tour of duty affect my life expectancy in the open universe? Will I come out of Squadron 42 scarred and with cybernetic limbs, and can I suffer death of a spaceman during my tour of duty? I actually like that question.
That's an excellent question.
It's a good question.
It's a wonderful question. Yeah. But the death mechanic is slightly different in the single-player games. I mean, if you look back at Wing Commanders, right? If you die, you have to start the mission over. It's not like we're not going to do the full mechanic there. So, no, we don't expect you to have a shorter lifespan just because you went through Squadron 42.
In fact, you may have a longer lifespan because you'll have learned how to fly a fighter properly by going
hopefully.
Through the campaign.
Hopefully.
Yeah, if we, yeah, it'll be, those guys, the Foundry 42 guys will make it properly difficult.
Your results may vary.
Your results may vary. From, another name. This is a subscriber, Fionis Kadar,
I tried to pick really hard names for you.
You did. You absolutely did. Will we be flying mostly fighters, like Wing Commander, or will we be seeing ourselves taking command of some larger ships in some scenarios? P.S. You guys are awesome. You make dreams come true for all of us. Thank you. P.S. There's a 2.0 P.S. Give the guy that did the Retaliator a manly hug for me. It looks epic.
It does look epic.
Yeah, so we'll you know, first of all, we'll give a manly hug to him. We'll give him a big circle hug. But... what's the answer to this question? So, can you fly larger ships, or are we going to be limiting them to just fighters, or?
I think that may fall into the category of a spoiler warning. So.
Spoiler warning.
Plan for.
So the answer is redacted.
Oh. Man.
From Similion, will we have access to ships that we purchased for Squadron 42?
Now that we can answer.
Okay. Good. Yes.
So Squadron 42 is, again, like Wing Commanders in the past, you're in the military. You're not going to be flying your Constellation in the military. It won't fit on the carrier very well anyway. So, yeah, you could plan to be flying your Hornets and Gladiators and other ships that you may not have met yet.
The good news is it's going to be really high-tech military hardware. You aren't going to be able to get in Star Citizen, so you're going to have a completely different experience in some of these ships.
So on the count of three, the answer will be 1, two, three.
No.
I like long answers.
I know. From Isonix, will our character be a set avatar like Colonel Bluehair, or will this be a customizable avatar? Will there be a return of the possible drunk mission? Will there be Colonel called Bluehair? And finally, will we have as much or more awesome interactive dialogue like Wing Commander 3 and Wing Commander 4? Wow, that is a lot of questions.
That's a lot of questions.
Listen, I feel where you're coming from.
Yeah.
You just have to let go. This is a new universe. It's going to be even cooler than Wing Commander.
Yeah.
Plus, I think some former publishers we worked with might not take too kindly to. But I wouldn't be surprised to see some homage stuff pop up here and now and again. You
never
know?
Can tell, but probably not blue hair. It's
you know
not
what?
Really a name.
But this would be a spoiler alert too. These are kind of things that the fans would want to play through and discover for themselves. So, you know, and that's one thing we need to get out there is we'd like to answer everything we can, but we want to be cognizant of the experience that you guys are going to have. We want to make sure that you get to experience it the way we want you to experience it and not knowing everything going in, right?
Right. And we talked about the drunk mission a lot yesterday. And you know, the honest answer on that one is it's really not much fun. You play it once to get the experience and you know, look at how messed up your controls are and everything. And then you're like, well, I can't win this. You go back, you skip the drinks, and then you go fly the mission normally. So,
well, if you want a drunk mission, you can just grab a beer out of the fridge.
That's true. You can. We cannot tell you how to play our game.
Any mission can be the drunk mission. From Kraken, will we have to redo the campaign for each citizen heir when our character dies? Thinking about Squadron 42 replayability value, will the choices open entire different paths with completely different missions?
Two questions. So first things first, dead character. If this is your next of kin, then you already have the benefits from Squadron 42, right? So you don't need to play it again because you can't get them again in the same account, on that same character account.
Mm-hmm.
Now, maybe if you open a new character, you could replay it for that character, but not for that single chain.
All right, Ben, you want to take the... Will the choices open different paths with completely different missions?
Yeah, we're going to see branching missions for sure. In fact, that was one of the stretch goals. As you were saying, a lot of people played through the original games without going and playing the losing missions or the mid-range missions. Yeah. There's going to be some cool stuff in there.
But don't expect like an entirely separate, you know, path that just goes off forever in a different direction. You know, we want the dialogue to be tight, the storyline to be tight. So it'll do small branches, but not necessarily vast branches.
Okay. More like Wing Commander 3. If you
exactly. Wing Commander 3's tree was kind of linear with jig-jags.
You should see the script for Wing Commander 4. I think you've actually got a copy. It is like this thick. It is unbelievably detailed and dialogue-heavy. From Vol, the planetary environments are starting to look interesting, and several stretch goals have focused on expanding ground-based combat. With this in mind, will Squadron 42 feature any ground combat or boarding sections? Do we want it? Is this a spoiler thing, or is this a... What do you guys think?
I think we'll just say we're building that technology for a reason.
That's a good answer, Ben. I like that answer.
Nothing to redact there, Ben.
He's gotten good at this.
I know, it's amazing. From J-Tech Priest, will there be romance in Squadron 42? Please no. Is there going to... There might be bromance. Right?
We're focused in...
Bromance. All right, is there going to be romance? Because, I mean, we had a little bit of...
We're focusing very heavily in this particular storyline on interactions with individual wingmen, but in terms of, you know, how you treat each other as comrades, not necessarily, you know, getting into some big mushy romance, especially since we don't know what character you're going to be playing. You know, you could be picking a female or a male, so we can't really react to all those situations.
Yeah, that would be an immense amount of dialogue.
I'll just say that we had a conversation about this yesterday, and it got very silly very quickly, so...
We can't repeat.
Wait.
You can't repeat all of this.
You're saying that sitting around with a bunch of designers designing games can get silly?
No, that never happens. Very serious people.
Yeah, right. From Groundhound, Wingman, I loved Wing Commander 3's little active and passive animations. For instance, if you walked into the barracks, you could watch Vaquero play his guitar. Then when you scrolled over him and the mouse, he looked up at you. Can we expect similar situations in Squadron 42 where your crewmates will go about their business and turn to interact with you when they notice you nearby?
You want to go with that one, Ben?
Yes.
Good answer.
Yes, that is true. And that, you know, that's, look, what does Chris always talk about?
Immersion,
right? And that's part of what makes the universe seem alive and vibrant, correct? Yep. Is all those little things that we get to see and do. And so, one, two, three?
Yes.
from Lon. Between mission and Squadron 42, between missions, while aboard a carrier or other ship, will there be a limit to where we can go on that ship?
Well, we're building all the interiors out fully, so you should be able to walk around everywhere, right?
Yeah.
That'll be neat.
Okay.
You know, I mean, if they'll let you in. I mean, you can't go everywhere, everywhere.
Right. I mean, I imagine if you're a lieutenant, you're not able to go to the command center or whatever. I mean, well, that's a question. I mean, are we going to open up new areas for people to go to as the mission progresses?
Absolutely. Ooh,
that sounds like a good plan.
You need to configure a loadout, they'll open up that area for you.
But I can imagine Skadi chasing you with a wrench if you try to go into the engine room.
Scott.
I mean, not Skadi. I'm sorry. We're not using
Skadi, my God.
Sorry, what was his
name? My God, man.
We need a new name.
His name was Blue Hair. It was Colonel Blair, I think.
Is that grandmother?
No. From Fox, in the Squadron 42 campaign and subsequently in the player universe, how are conversations going to be handled? Is it going to be like Mass Effect, where you have a Paragon choice or a Renegade choice, and possibly something neutral? Or is there going to be more depth in decisions depending on the personality of the people, NPC, that you're interacting with? Also, how much impact are the responses you make going to impact your reputation or how your crew responds or acts while you're on a mission? I'm now going to take a breath.
I like watching you read those long questions. I could have edited that one down a little bit.
You should have edited that one down, yes.
No, it looked good watching you do that.
If the answer on the page is like 1/10 of that.
It's much shorter than the question, yes. We gave ourselves the easy job.
Uh-huh.
So there actually is a little more to it than that one-line answer. But basically, as I spoke about a little earlier, the character's reactions to you change based on whether you agree or disagree with them. It's not a right or wrong thing. It's not, I'm going to take the angel path or the devil path. It's the, do I think the same way as this person does? And my reactions to other people, to missions, to what happens during the story. So yeah, it'll affect how they fly with you, how they react to you if you ever get to command them, all of that.
Ben, would you say that's like a reputation system then, sort of? The more you hang around with people, you sort of get, they like you. It's more of a like kind of thing, isn't it?
I'm going to call it a reputation web.
There you go.
Ooh, a reputation web. Different from our other reputation system, however.
There you go. From Butch, will there be some kind of offline mode for the Hangar module and eventually Squadron 42 so you don't have to be online to log in?
Well, you have to be online on the Hangar because you have to be able to get to your account. Squadron 42 will probably give you the option. We talked about this as well. It's like, what if they really just want to play that single-player game? That's
all.
Yeah,
well, yeah.
So if you don't want to make a character that passes on into the persistent universe, we'll probably let you make a character and
but none of
just
those
play through
people,
the game.
Everybody out there wants to definitely go through the persistent universe.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, we're not talking about you people.
All right, from Trapjaw. Ahoy, Wingman. Are there any plans to extend the single-player game to that of a civilian or pirate's perspective, a privateer-style set of missions that players can run through rather than Squadron 42 ones? Ben, what do you think?
There's always mission discs.
Yeah. You know, not initially, right? That's the right answer. Not in the first iteration.
We have a lot of ideas for other stories to tell, and Star Citizen is giving us the tools we need to tell those stories in the long run.
Exactly. We're going to be building the tools to make those stories. Mm-hmm. We'll follow the lore that the players themselves are going to create. Mm-hmm. We'll let them inspire some of the things we want to do. There'll be big epic adventures going on in the universe mm-hmm. that we will, possibly create some redacted.
Tales of Ben the Pirate?
Tales of Ben the Pirate. Arr, Ben.
I am just a fisherman.
I am just a fisherman.
It's a good cover.
I'm a leaf on the wind. From Lars, who's also a subscriber. Thank you, Lars. Hey, Wingman. From what I understand, pilots who have completed the Squadron 42 campaign will be able to carry their military background and achievements into Star Citizen. Is there a chance these players can be drafted back into the military in case of an extreme emergency in the persistent universe? I promise I will not mind the military pulling me back from time to time to help defend the UEE.
I can neither confirm nor deny.
We've actually answered that one before, though.
Oh, darn.
So they go back through the things. if you
so,
guys,
so what did we say before?
I'm not going to say that. If you guys don't want to, they can go back and find out.
Maybe.
Some interesting ideas.
It's a definite maybe.
Well, I mean, you know, if you're a reservist, you're a reservist, right?
Definite maybe.
We had a very interesting conversation about this yesterday with the guys from the UK.
We had a lot of very interesting conversations, some of them, which
good.
We can't repeat
and,
here.
And we're not going to talk about those here, are we?
No.
But we are going to go out to the UK and talk to them there, and maybe we can ferret out that information from the fishermen. Mission discs, perhaps?
Who knows?
No, don't know. We don't know about that. All right, now it's time for our own And Lesnick with this week's most valuable post.
Take it away, me. Hey everyone, welcome to MVP, Most Valuable Post. I'm Community Manager Ben Lesnick, and I'm here to tell you what our favorite post at the RSI Forums was this week. The honor goes to Silver Volpe for his post, Shout Out to Etiquette, which is just a very great reminder that we can have disagreements on the internet without being at each other's throats. And that's something really any forum could use. And he just does an excellent job of explaining how that works. An etiquette tip from me: use your salad knife with your left hand and your Ben hammer with your right hand. And a very special second shout out to the fish cam from Skadi. This is making the star citizen rounds. He pointed a camera at the fish tank in his hangar and he has just been broadcasting it. And the reactions it has gotten are incredible. So check that out, watch his Midas fish swim around.
Thanks, Ben. And now it's time for Wide World News. Scott Carpenter, the fourth U.S. astronaut to fly in space and the second to orbit Earth, died October 10th after suffering a recent stroke. He was 88 years old. Chosen in 1959 among NASA's first astronauts, Carpenter made his first and only spaceflight on May 24th, 1962, when he became the sixth man worldwide to leave the planet. During his Mercury 7 mission, Carpenter circled the Earth three times, conducted some of the first astronaut science experiments, and consumed the first solid space food. Small square cubes composed of chocolate, figs, and dates mixed with high-protein cereals. And the best part of Carpenter's Mercury mission is his spacecraft named the Aurora. And now it's time for a little more recent news with This Week in Space.
October 15th, 2003, and Yang Liwei is preparing to become the first Chinese taikonaut. Demonstrating his indefatigable spirit and unyielding perseverance, this former fighter squadron leader in the People's Liberation Army Air Force has endured a training regimen of unprecedented rigor. Everything is ready at the Jiquan Launch Center. Yang Liwei, spirited and assured, makes his way into the Shenzhou 5, the largest manned spacecraft in the world. On his shoulders rests the task of achieving glory for the nation. Shenzhou 5 launches into space, carried by the Shenzhen 2F rocket, nicknamed the Magic Arrow. The flight upwards is successful, and the spacecraft enters its orbit 10 minutes later. In a 21-hour mission, Liwei will orbit the Earth 14 times, making a journey of 600,000 kilometers. While orbiting past midnight on October 16th, Liwei will tell Mission Control that he feels good. That remark, understated yet overwhelming, will invigorate a billion hearts, reverberating in the minds of countless people in China. Yang Liwei, Zhongguo's first taikonaut.
And now, a thought-provoking break with our very own Mark Skelton.
So what happened to the other 41 squadrons?
Everybody. Well, as you know, version 2 of the Hangar came out last week, and we thought it might be kind of fun to give you a little bit of the enjoyment we had in getting that thing out. So with me today, we have Kyle, we have Justin, Harry, and Mark, and we're going to talk a little about the experience of getting the Hangar V2 out. So welcome, everybody. Are you ready to do this?
Sure.
Ready to talk about this?
I need a nap.
You need a nap, right. So Wednesday, you know, we're going to kind of scroll through some of this stuff, and we're going to talk a little bit about, like, you know, some of the things that were said in the chat room. And when we first put this together, Harry, how many pages were on the
when
chat?
When I started from Wednesday to Saturday were 38 pages of Skype chat.
38 pages of Skype chat. Now, we won't show you all of that because, well, it's not probably for general consumption. So on Wednesday, Jason starts us all off by saying, I'm repurposing this chat for general release discussion. And then I say, I need an update from all departments about the status of the hangar, the following elements: buggy track, fish tank, Avenger, message panels, character swap, etc. Justin, give us the update. What happened that day? What did we have working? What didn't we have working?
Well, we had some issues where the character swap, the outfit swap, the character when it was wearing the privateer outfit wasn't having, didn't have hands.
Didn't have hands.
Yeah, for some reason.
You think the fans would notice that?
Yeah.
I don't think it's a big deal.
Yeah. Who needs hands anyway?
Yeah. You're overrated.
Yeah. Use your feet.
Yeah. And we gloves. The Avenger wasn't in the hangar yet. The LCD screens weren't in there yet. Mm-hmm. But the fish tank was.
Fish tank.
We did have a fish tank there.
Right.
And there were some issues with the Constellation that...
And the buggy track.
Yeah, there was no buggy track.
At that point, or none, mm-hmm. you know, there's being worked on, but it wasn't mm-hmm. in the yeah. actual release yet.
And there were some issues with the Constellation that popped up afterwards that weren't in the last patch. But yeah, with the getting in the turret and...
Yeah, the offsets.
Yeah,
there were some animation offsets that were not supposed to be there.
Okay, so that's a good question. So Kyle, from the programming side, folks probably want to know, if it's working once and you just add something, why doesn't it work again?
I mean, it's a ton of people all checking in stuff that sometimes it stomps something, or sometimes, you know, you change the little thing not thinking it's going to affect this system over here, and it does, and you're just like, well, why did that happen? So it's a lot of, everyone has to kind of work together with, you know, I'm working on this and you're working on that, and we have to make sure that we're all working on the same stuff together so that we're not stomping each other or, you know, checking in something that breaks everything. And so we have a build system that does a lot of continuous integration to make sure that whatever we check in doesn't just break everything. But we don't have like a test system. So Justin is our only QA tester. He's running, every time we make a new build, he's testing it. And there's a lot of stuff there that needs to be tested for one person.
Yeah, a lot of moving parts.
Yeah, and to be fair, the key part of this process is we let the fans out there be part of our QA, but we are going to be adding QA to a lot more QA. We just need, I don't know, office space.
That would be nice. Yeah, I mean, a lot of the thing is that it's a linear process. So what it is it's like you can't just take any element out of it without conceivably domino affecting the whole thing.
Sure,
you know what I mean? And we have a lot of people working on a lot of different things in a lot of different locations. So to coordinate all that and have everything come in like at a single point is a huge amount of management, you know, and talking to, you know, it's like not only the ships.
That week was a little rough.
I mean, especially the ships, because the ships are like, they're so... They involve everyone, all the way down. I mean, from the XML files, loading in the weapons and the swap outs to, you know, actually setting up the ship through engineering and then art, you know.
Animations.
So, yeah. So, I mean, all that stuff is integrated in these ships. And so, again, if you find something that's messed up or there's a bug, then you fix it and conceivably you've broken other things, you know. So... It just happens that way. I mean, that's the way, you know, things that you can't foresee, like, happen because there's so many moving parts.
Sure.
You know, it's like taking out a spark plug of your car, you know. It's like, well, conceivably, if you keep it that way, it's going to break your car.
Right.
You know,
it's the engine.
Yeah, it's going to, there's a lot of things that cascade down from that.
Sure.
So.
And as Harry, you mentioned, it was a very, very busy week for us as we had CitizenCon. So that was pretty much Wednesday, where we were Wednesday. And then from there, we went to Thursday. Now, Thursday, we didn't get a lot of work done on the actual version 2 because we were all focused on CitizenCon and getting the demo machine up and running mm-hmm. and getting everything ready and all the videos in place, and our own Mike Morlan and Ian out there and everybody else were crammed. And so while we were working on stuff, and by the way, Behavior was here,
yeah.
Turbulent was here, everybody was everybody was here.
Everybody was working on stuff for us was
yeah.
here. So
yeah.
it's like, yeah. hey man, where's that thing?
Was here.
Where's that thing you're working on?
And why is this broken? Right. So let's skip ahead to Friday because we were all thinking, Friday's the day, we're going to get version 2 out to them, and let's just take a little bit of look at that. So I got Jason at 9:54 p.m. on Friday, which is worth, we're thinking at this point, we're going to get out of here at 10:30, 11 on Friday night. And Jason says, starting build. Yeah, Rob comes back immediately and says, can't find the metadata, problem for the fans. We've had that problem before, Kyle.
Metafile.
The metafile, yeah, the metafile problem. What happens there?
So... with the build system, once we generate a build, we create a patch of it. And there's a couple different files that are associated with that patch that basically tell the patcher how to patch from where you are to where you need to go to.
Sure.
And when we upload stuff to the CDN, we need to make sure that all of those files are there and that they're actually generated. And we found that there was actually a bug that in the patch building system that didn't generate the right to-from patch. So we had to, after the fact, fix that, and that's what ended up solving that issue. But we found a bug in the system. I mean, it was deep down in there that we had no idea was there until we ran an automated promotion system that we had just developed this week.
Yes, and then we are pretty much on the bleeding edge of these kind of things. And then at 12:30, Chris says, isn't anyone worried that the build is taking more than an hour? And everybody pretty much goes, yeah. So, Harry, what happened? We had like some big files in this build that we didn't have before, right?
Well, one thing we were adding was the Aurora video, the commercial, which was a fairly sizable file. And even though the patch system does a diff and doesn't try to download the whole patch every time, still that's a big add. So we weren't sure if that big of an add of a single file was what causing this. So we were kind of sort of trying to do some investigation, trying to figure out, is this what's slowing it down? Is that the one thing?
Sure.
We weren't sure, and it turns out there were other things going on in the background that we weren't aware of at the time that were biting us.
I mean, we basically have to work around bugs in the Microsoft Visual Studio tool chain that cause issues like just hanging builds, and it's stuff that we have to try to work around as best
and they look
can.
Like they're progressing.
Yeah.
They're just progressing slowly.
Yeah.
You're not sure what's going on.
Yeah. Right. So we go through a little bit of the night now, and now we're at 2:38, and we started build number 213 with our fingers crossed. And at 4:27, Jason chimes in and says, ah, looks like another VC plus toolchain bug is being hit again. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. I mean, there are issues that Visual Studio has with parallel builds. So to speed up our build time, we do a lot of compilation in parallel with each other. And Microsoft really doesn't support that very well, at least it seems.
What a shock.
So we have things like that to work around. Sometimes it's just a simple restart of one of the build slaves, and sometimes, like, we have no idea.
And of course,
why.
It's 4 a.m. when we.
No.
Yeah, so we're all rolling our hair.
It's 4 a.m. at that time, but now let's jump ahead to 5:15 where we start build 218.
Yes.
And it looks like 218 goes through, and it says we're adding the 375 from Jason. He talks a little about it. And then John Erskine chimes in and says, if this patch is so big, we should probably prep high winds so that there are any issues when we release it. Now, Justin, who's high winds?
High winds is the outsourcer that's in charge of the actual movement of the download through our patch system.
It's called a content delivery network.
Right,
CDN.
CDN, for short. Yeah. But you had already alerted them that this was going to be a rather large patch, right?
I was not around.
This is a good point. Yeah. So Kyle had taken a couple days of PTO,
that's
right?
That's right. That's
and
right.
So Jason was handling a lot of this. Yeah. But, you know, we have that redundancy here. So we get new to the test. It starts at about 7:15 in the morning. We start testing. And then Jason says at 12:50, we're still testing, several different problems are causing the unable to load manifest error. So there may be many issues merged together, but it looks like it goes through and Harry's testing it at, it looks to me like 2:00 in the afternoon. You say you have two patches left and it looks like it's going through. Harry says 20 minutes plus for these two patches. Chris is like, yes. And then Rob Irving chimes in with $30 million stretch goal, new patch release. Which is one of the things we actually can say to people about, you know, that happens on this. And then Harry chimes in at 2:40 and says, you just checked the deluxe. The video is looping correctly. And I say it looks like I'm there at 4:26 going, what's our patch update? And Jason says, data patch still uploading to CDN. And it looks like it finally went through. Ron chimes in at 5:44 p.m. on Saturday, which is a good, I don't know, 40 hours later, that it says it worked, and Chris chimes in and says, thanks all, great work.
Yep.
So that is the kind, sometimes getting things done, we are really, really on the edge of these things, and sometimes getting these things done is a little more difficult than we anticipate. And, you know, we had a lot going on last week.
Yeah.
We had CitizenCon, we had the summit, which was very important. We had all the people that were going to be working on stuff in town, so they, you know, they had to find machines at times to work on things.
And
so,
as you know, we have lots of space here, so
for the And Thursday night was our cocktail party with the fans, we weren't feeling the sharpest.
That's right. We had lots of coffee Friday morning to get some things going.
Friday morning was a slow start.
Yeah. But we finally got it out. We finally got it out. Justin, you were here for like forever during this thing. And
yeah, it was a 16-hour stretch for me at least.
And we got it out, and the fan reaction has been what?
Yeah, I think they love it so far, especially the new Avenger. It was a shame that we weren't able to show actually getting into the ship and getting into the cargo bay for the demo. But but once we got the patch out, they're able to do that, and I think they're definitely loving the.
Good. I mean, it's iterative. We add things left and right, and then we break things, and sometimes the best laid plans don't happen. So, hey, everybody, that's kind of an inside look at what it's like to release something directly to you at Cloud Imperium. I want to thank all the subscribers and pledgers, subscribers particularly, for allowing us to make these kind of shows and get that information to you on a weekly basis. Coming up this week, well, we hope to have the Hornet brochure and variants. Right, Harry? It's getting close. Bryan Brewer, our own lead animator, is out doing animation master's class. We'll have a little bit about that next week. We have a live orchestral recording of the Star Citizen music being done. We'll get an update with Martin Galloway about how that's going. Join our YouTube channel. You'll find out what happens on a day-to-day basis. As soon as we post something up, you'll get pinged. You'll know. We'll know. Send your questions in to the RSI forums so that we can get those. And by the way, all the questions that were in this week that we didn't get to because we did a Squadron 42, we got them for next week, especially video questions. Very, very cool. We love them. Check out Wingman's Hangover. It comes up about 15 minutes after the show. I know it's been a little long episode today, but we're still going to have some fun. Join the chat roll. We get some Skype calls. We get some direct interaction. And we find out what you liked
and what you didn't like about the show.
So thanks a lot. Remember, if you want your stuff featured here on Wingman's Hangover, send it in. We just might use it. Where are we going to see him?
In the verse.
God.
Star Citizen and 42 episodes of Wingman's Hangar.
And that means presents!
So, we have this, made by fans you have inspired over the last year. Enjoy!
Hello my fellow pilots, and hello at everyone at Cloud Imperium Games. Dr. Hawk here with Star Citizen FM, wishing you guys a happy anniversary on Star Citizen. You guys take care, and fly safe.
Congratulations everyone on the 1 year anniversary. Chris Roberts, CIG, and the fans of course, Wingman's Hangar, which also congratulations on your 42nd episode. Awesome! Can't wait, always enjoy watching the show, and especially excited for this one. I'll see you in the verse.
Wait a minute. I think somebody's coming.
quick, hide that. Oh, hey, nothing going on here. Just a little 3D editing. But, hey, while I'm at it, all you guys at CIG, RSI, Chris Roberts, happy anniversary and happy birthday from the guys at Jazz Aero Designs.
Wow, 1 year and $21 million. Chris, that's a whole lot of trust. Congratulations. Happy birthday, Star Citizen. Congratulations, Wingman, on 42 episodes of The Hangar. Love the show. Keep going on and ever upward.
Dr. Quick here. Salutations to Chris Roberts and the CIG team on this your first year anniversary. Owen, can I get a woot for 21 million clams raised for the soon-to-be best damn space sim ever?
Hi, Star Citizen, this is Exec from Berlin. One of the happiest events last year was your birth. And now, 1 year later, I have to say, I'm so glad you grew up without chains or restrictions of any publisher or investor. You are not just a game, you are a dream. Happy birthday, Star Citizen.
This is Batgirl, a.k.a. Irina. I want to wish you a very happy first anniversary, and thank you so much for bringing the Star Citizen universe to us. Can't wait to see what you have in store for us over the next year, but take tomorrow off, well, not really, and have a wonderful anniversary.
Hey, Cloud Imperium, it's Alex here, and I wanted to congratulate you on the 42nd episode of Wingman's Hangar and the first anniversary, so congratulations. We all appreciate your work.
Dear Commander Roberts, congratulations to you and your crew at Cloud Imperium Games for the first anniversary of Star Citizen. You have done a wonderful job and keep up the good work for the next years. These greetings are sent to you by Colonel Snaplight
and Vestra.
Congratulations on a great first year, Cloud Imperium, and thanks for taking us along for the ride. Have some cake on us. And we will see you in the verse.
I think it's a little hotter than I thought before.
Pew 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 pew! This is Chris from Norway, firing the turrets to celebrate 10-10, Star Citizen Announcement Day. Keep up the good work and we'll keep on breaking your servers.
Hey Wingman, it's Lee here. Just wanted to congratulate you on the 42nd episode. And also, seriously, has it been that long? Congratulations also on the 1 year anniversary of Star Citizen since the original announcement. Just wow. And I'm pretty sure I'm speaking for everyone here when I say we cannot wait to get our hands on the stuff that you're producing. It is just unbelievable work. Seriously, keep up the great work, guys. Absolutely amazing. And congratulations again. And until next time, take care.
Greetings, Chris. This is Rebuck from Eternal Vigilance. Congratulations on year one to you and everyone at CIG, and allowing all of us to ride along on this journey with you, from all of us. Thank you, and here's to the next year.
Indeed.
Some say the magic of the gaming industry is dead. Others say it's all about business and not the consumers. But you, yes you, have stood up for us, and in turn, we support you and appreciate you. In wishing to a happy birthday to Star Citizen from all of us to you.
Hey, it's Heartsblade here. I just want to thank Chris Roberts and the team and congratulate them on an awesome first year of development for Star Citizen, and I'm really looking forward to what they're going to bring us in the coming years.
Hey, Menesny here. Congratulations on the first anniversary of Star Citizen. Keep up the good work. I'm looking forward to doing some hunting in the universe.
Hey, Wingman, Blonk here. Since you're the closest one to me being in the Cathcar system, I'm sending this transmission to you. Happy anniversary and a big thank you to the entire CIG team, especially to Chris Roberts. Thank you guys for making the game that I always wanted to play ever since I laid my hands on the PC. And of course, for showing the finger to the publishers. Glug out.
Shiver me timbers!
Hey, CIG, happy first anniversary in the verse.
La 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 la.
Oh shit. Excuse me. Whatever. Happy 1 year anniversary to Chris Roberts and the teams at CIG.
Hey Wingman! Hey Star Citizen team! Griffin here. So, happy birthday! As a special present, I have... you can get anything that's in that crate I'm going to open.
Give me a sec.
And let's see what's in here. There are coupons. And they're all void. Anyway, happy birthday, Star Citizen team. Griffin out.
Hello, Chris Roberts, Wingman, and Cloud Imperium Games. Congratulations on hitting the 21 million mark and your 1 year anniversary. In 1 year, you've achieved more than anyone thought possible, and I hope you will astound us even more in the next year. I have to go now. It looks like Captain Mitch has spotted me.
Ah, Captain Mitch reporting in. I was calling to give a congratulations to Mr. Roberts and all of CIG for the 1 year anniversary of Star Citizen.
Sir, let's not forget about the historic 21 million full funding mark.
Thank you, Commander. I almost forgot.
Captain, we have detected a pirate ship.
Red alert, raise shields.
Aye, Captain.
Sorry, I gotta take care of this.
Ken Chatham again. Just want to say congratulations on the anniversary of Star Citizen and the 42nd episode of Wingman's Hangar. And I just want to say thank you for this awesome coupon for a free cutlass you guys sent me. I mean, it's not even expired. Son of a...
Hey, I just want to say to everyone, what's the... No. What? Whoa! Whoa!
Oh, I'm not freaking dust.
Whoa, I'm dust!
Hi there, my name is Brigand, and I'm about to tell you a secret. Why the hell should I own one of those for a PC game? And the answer is, of course, Squadron 42. You would need one of those to stay on top in a dogfight. Yeah, eat this. Well, that being said, that would make Squadron 42 the answer to the question of life. I think we all knew that already, didn't we? Happy anniversary, Star Citizens and Eric Michael Robb. Congratulations for the 42nd episode of Wingman's Hangar. Everybody at Cloud Imperium Games, thank you for building our dream.
The Hitchhiker's Guide remark has already been made, so I just have to say thank you for listening to us seriously and...
Congratulations!
We'll be right back.
citizen!
I guess it is.
Dad has some weird friends.
When I get older, I'm gonna grow up like Mom.
Happy birthday, Star Citizen!